Okay, so our introduction to animal spatial ecology. So kind of just to keep a brief refresher from yesterday's slides, again, movement's fundamental to life history and fitness of organisms. And this is often studied using different forms of telemetry, whether it's GPS, Argos, or radio telemetry, using VHF telemetry. And here the focus is going to be on space use as opposed to behavioral states. And this still, again, falls generally within this movement ecology paradigm. So certain things you can estimate by measuring space use of an individual or a population are the space use of that individual or an entire population as a whole. Additionally, you could look into temporal patterns, whether that's at a daily dial scale. Additionally, you can look at monthly or seasonal or annual patterns, or have it relate to a migratory or breeding season versus a season outside of that. You can look at relationships with protected areas, whether marine or terrestrial, make comparisons among different life stages of a species, and potentially determine centers of activity or core areas of use. So, to try to define this, what is spatial ecology? So to take a passage from a textbook by Fletcher and Fortin, spatial ecology focuses on the study and modeling of the roles of space on ecological processes that in turn affects ecological patterns. And that's pretty broad. And that's because it can encompass a large number of things. But for today, as this figure from Whitmire shows, there's these different aspects you can focus on, whether it's the behavioral component in the top left, or the structural component of connectivity, maybe across the landscape in the top right. You can even estimate things such as fitness landscapes to the right of this this track. But what we're going to focus on here is potentially the intensity of space use here on the left. So we're really interested in how much space these animals are using, and generally would like to consider this as like a probability density surface if possible, to look at this intensity. So the way I consider spatial ecology as differentiating from movement ecology is that spatial ecology is more broad, in that it can be points that were just measured from a survey or just general point counts. You're just looking at the spatial distribution of points. Whereas movement ecology kind of more implies that you're evaluating an animal that's been tagged. So you have these tracks or trajectories that you're analyzing. So that's not always the case for measuring space use. But for today, that will be the case. So there is some overlap if thinking about this like from a Venn diagram perspective. So how to actually study space use or spatial intensity. And to start off, I'd like to discuss the concept of home ranges. So there's a lot of different terminology in the literature, and a lot of times things are used interchangeably. So I'd like to try to provide some more clear-cut definitions as to how these terms are generally being used by people that conduct work more frequently in this field. So there's a book chapter by Horn and colleagues from a couple years ago, and taking basically a definition used or originally defined essentially like 80 years ago by Burt, they define home ranges as the consequence of behavioral and environmental process that results in predictable patterns of restricted space use on the landscape. Additionally, animals might occasionally make exploratory forays, but home ranges should be those areas that are normally used. And temporal stability in the area used is expected, such that an animal will make repeated visits to places within the home range. So home ranges are basically areas that are highly used, and there's a high level of site fidelity that's essentially being exhibited here. So there might be occasional movements outside of the home range that the animal might make just to explore, to search for food, or search for a mate. But in general, it will stay at a given home range potentially for the rest of its life once it's established. And that's not always the case for all species. So I think this concept especially was originally developed in the context of studying terrestrial organisms. And that's very different from what we see in especially marine organisms, where some might undergo these long migratory movements and potentially disperse across entire ocean basins and do so regularly. So home range might not be necessarily the best term that we're always looking for when trying to talk about space use, especially in highly mobile marine organisms. But so this just kind of sets the stage and defines one aspect of space use, but how are we going to estimate space use more specifically? So one way to do so that was kind of developed originally in a while, it's like I think 1947 was when this was first kind of used for animal space use, is minimum convex polygons. So essentially is creating this convex hull around the outermost points of what could be a track or again a set of points from a survey. And it's arguably the simplest method of all those that are available. So because it creates a convex hull around these outermost points, it's extremely sensitive to outliers and your sample size. So you'll see here on this bottom image or figure that I've created that we have this increased density of points that's closer to the middle. But this minimum convex polygon is essentially connecting all these points around the outer ring here. And it's saying that space use is going to be this entire area, but it has no notion of the intensity of use. So we just assume this whole area is used the same in this case. And let's say we were to collect points from like another day or another week from this individual, this minimum convex polygon might increase like twofold, threefold, fourfold. So there's a lot of issues with trying to use a minimum convex polygon to actually estimate how much space an animal is using. But because this was relatively simple, this is one of the first methods that were originally used and developed. The next major form is the utilization distribution. And the utilization distributions are essentially characterizing space use as a density function. So it's essentially characterizing the spatial intensity of use and doing so through statistics. So this differs from minimum convex polygons in that you can look at relatively high use areas by comparison and therefore isn't as sensitive to the sample size and outliers as minimum convex polygons. So we'll see here for this bottom expression, mathematical expression, this is denoting the probability of space use. So capital S representing space here, the spatial region. And we're essentially integrating over that spatial region with this function, the 2D or the bivariate probability density function in both the X and the Y direction. So this is just a general expression, but this would be essentially some bivariate probability density function. So it could be like a bivariate normal distribution or something else. There's a few different types of what are called kernels, which essentially represent these probability density functions that can be used for this process. And frequently used methods to estimate UDs or the utilization distributions include kernel density estimation, which I'm sure many of you are familiar with, as well as Browning Bridge movement models, which were originally proposed in, I think, 2007 by Horn and colleagues, which was adapted from a master's thesis that someone had written in 1999. So these are the two major methods I'll be covering regarding the estimation of utilization distributions today. And this figure on the right from Silva and colleagues from 2020 shows the estimation of UDs from different types of methods. So the top row is showing estimates from a dynamic Brownian bridge movement model. The second row is kernel density estimates using a reference bandwidth estimator. The third row is kernel density estimation using a least squares cross-validation method. and the bottom row is minimum convex polygons. And these colors are denoting the commission, so the inclusion of points along a simulated track, or the omission, or not including a set of points. And each column is a different time interval that was used, essentially. So making a comparison among these different available methods. Okay. So to kind of break down utilization distributions a bit further, there's, I would say, two general types of utilization distributions that you'd want to think about when trying to estimate space use for a study. And these are the occurrence distribution and the range distribution. So I took this figure from Crane and colleagues from this recent paper from last year. And I think this does a really good job of making this comparison. So an occurrence distribution, I would say in general, is what most people are trying to quantify. And it's essentially estimating the space potentially used by the animals during the sampling period. So you're just trying to see or estimate what space was used, whereas the range distribution to the right is trying to estimate what space could be used, whether currently or in the future at some point. And this more closely matches up with that concept or definition of a home range that Burt proposed in his 1943 paper. So if we're talking about utilization distributions and we want to estimate the space that was used during a sampling period, we may need to be more specific in our language and refer to this also as an occurrence distribution instead of potentially a range distribution or a home range. So definitely keep that in mind as you're defining how you're going to be estimating space use, and then also which method you're going to choose to do so. So in this figure on the left for the occurrence distribution, the dynamic Browning Bridge movement model is being used here to estimate space use, whereas on the right side for the range distribution, the autocorrelated kernel density estimate method is being used. So some potential issues to consider as you're designing your study or determining which method you would like to use is why estimate space use for your study. And there's a good paper from Luca Berger and John Feiberg from, I think it's 2012, where it's like rephrase home range as a question. So you really need to think about why you're estimating space use besides just estimating it for the sake of doing it because other studies did it. So you wanted to match up with your research objectives as to what you're trying to glean from measuring space use. Also, what's your sample size? And this comes down to the number of individuals you tagged or tracked, as well as the number of observations for each of these individuals. What is the tracking duration? So in some cases, you might have really high temporal resolution data, but it's only sampling for like a week. If you have like maybe an accelerometer that's also taking GPS positions, but for other tags, you might be tracking an animal for over a year. And this can also highly vary among individuals that you've tagged. What is the time interval of tag transmissions? So if you have tags that are transmitting very frequently, you're going to have a lot of underlying autocorrelation in these points. Whereas if they're sampling much less frequently, there's going to be less autocorrelation. And this will dictate how you need to account for the independence of these points along the track. All right, so now we can start estimating space use.